Today, I finally get back to working on my Jeep. This is my 82 Jeep Scrambler. I'm Kevin. This is Ridge Runner Garage. Let me introduce you to my 82 Jeep CJ8 or Scrambler. I've always wanted one of these, but they are absolutely always been way out of my price range. I saw the ad for this one online. The guy also had a Jeep YJ for sale. This one, again, out of my price range. So I go to look at this YJ. Nice fixer-upper, flip it, make a few bucks. Well, I get there and this guy is literally me. He's into hot rods. He's into Jeeps. I ended up hanging out there for about 5 hours talking with a guy. He had this and he gave me such a great deal on both this and the YJ. I couldn't say no. So I finally got the Jeep I've always wanted. So the few of the things I'm going to work on today is you notice these CJ5s, CJ7s, and CJ8. They never have wheels like this on them. They always have just steel wagon wheels. Well, there's a reason for that. The front wheel studs are just way too short for anything like this. I'm going to show you, or attempt to show you, how I fix that problem. I'm going to show you a few things about brakes. There might be a few things that you guys could learn, or maybe even something you might not know. And there's a couple things about wiring that maybe I can show you and you can take onto your project. I already have one of these wheel studs out, so I was searching for longer wheel studs for this. But if you look, I think you can see it right there. Only 4 threads of engagement on each one of these wheel studs holding this wheel on. That is not enough. I'm no engineer, but that just seems like bad stuff can happen. All right, so I got the wheel off and I don't have a socket to fit this. So as you can imagine, hammer and screwdriver. I know you've all done this, but well, right off. Not the ideal way of doing it, but you gotta do it sometimes. So I need to separate the rotor from the hub because they're inboard, means the rotors are on the inside. Get all the wheel studs out. That's how you get the rotor off, because the bearing is on the outside. A lot of older stuff like this, I hate it, but it's what it is. All right, so this is the wheel stud off the CJ. Look at how short this thing is. Literally 1 inch of thread. 1 inch. It's not enough. And some guys actually, some of these older Jeeps had drum brakes and they did a disc brake conversion, so it made these wheel studs even worse. So that is why these things never have big wheels on them, or you can't get a lot of wheel options because this is so short. Now, I went to AutoZone and found this guy. Got a set of calipers. Went into the back room. They're a cool bunch of dudes. Let me go through and measure a bunch of wheel studs and find one that was very similar to what I was looking for. This one, the knurls measure out at 15.7 millimeters. This one, 15.8 millimeters, so it's literally the same thing. I'm knocking it through a bearing, it's not that big a deal. Now, there is a little bit of a difference in where the rotor rides. The rotor rides on this bigger part here, which is 16.6 millimeters, which is a millimeter bigger. And we have a millimeter narrower on this rotor. It's not gonna be a problem, and I'm gonna show you.
If you look and see that it moves ever so slightly in there, because it's not a hard fit, and there is enough knurl sticking out of the other side, so we'll have enough engagement in the bearings and the bolt, the wheel studs will hold them on, so we'll be good there. I'm going to show you how to get that to fit. All right, this is going to be my trick. This is a punch on my air hammer. What it's going to do is I'm going to use this punch to drive the wheel stud in right in the center in the back, and as it's punching in, it's going to spread the wheel stud out. I think it's safety glasses for this. Should really never mess with an air hammer without safety glasses. See too many chips go flying. All right, so problem not solved. My little compressor here just doesn't have the power that the one at work has, and I cannot get these mushroomed out enough. They're mushroomed out a little bit, but the knurls are enough to go in, but I'm not getting enough engagement so they come back out too easily. So my next option, I'm gonna weld them in there. So I'm gonna end up tack welding these things in. I thought this was gonna work. My air compressor just doesn't have it. I could wait till Tuesday and bring this to work because it's Labor Day weekend, but I don't really want to. The compressor at work probably should do this. We can spread this out, but there's nothing really wrong with tack welding them in. If you ever had to replace the rotor, you could just grind these things back off. It's not that big a deal. And another thing is they're dissimilar metals. So honestly, you probably weld that with a hammer hard enough, it'd probably break free anyhow. If you guys find yourself in this situation where you need to put longer wheel studs in your CJ, this is a Dorman package. These wheel studs are 610-347. They're 9/16 by 18. And whatever the length is, plenty long enough to solve our problem here, to use any kind of wheel that you want. That being said, I'm gonna continue on and weld the rest of these in here and repack the wheel bearings, and I'll get on the other side and see what I find. Actually, before I put this together, let me show you something about the brake caliper bracket that you probably should know.
You can't work on anything without an impromptu trip to the auto parts store. But I have the C10, so that's good.
Okay, so brakes. Here's where a lot of people miss the ball. Obviously, you've seen this little package of brake caliper grease that come with your pads if you get them. I have this bigger can here. And yes, it's for the sliders, right? And those move inside there. But in this particular situation, it's probably not the best example. Usually you'll see a stainless clip on top of this caliper bridge, if you will, or caliper bracket. This rusts up, and rust, it builds up. And what happens is, let me find a pad. The pad won't slide in here, and it'll, even though your clips will be on there, I've seen people hammer these things in here. These pads need to float in here, in and out, just like that, or it's a useless brake job. So I'm going to clean these up. I'm going to put brake caliper grease on here, There's no clips on these old Jeeps, the stainless clips that you see in modern cars. I think Chrysler didn't use these clips all the way up, probably to the early 2000s, but that's Chrysler for you. Anyways, make sure these surfaces are cleaned up and the pads slide in here just like they're supposed to do. Because when you step on the brake, the piston only pushes one side. The other side's just supposed to float in there. And if it's jammed in there and you have to hammer it in there, all it's going to do is wear funny, wear at an angle, and just ruin your brakes prematurely. I can't find either one of my bearing packing tools. This isn't going to be reinventing the wheel. I'm sure a lot of you have probably seen how to pack bearings and stuff on plenty of shows. Scoop grease in your hand, scoop the grease into the bearing, spin it as you do. You want the bearing and the grease to rise to the top up in here. So just keep doing that method. Scoop it into the bearing, scoop it into the bearing, give it a spin, scoop it into the bearing. And you'll see grease starting to come out at the top. And I'm just going to throw a handful of grease in here, just for extra, just for a bigger mess. There you go, mess made. It was worth mentioning, when you're putting one of these hubs back together, clean these up, grease them, and you see how the teeth in here only go to one side. They go all the way to the outside here and only part way. Make sure that right there, that side where the teeth go all to the outside, that's the spot that gets the engagement on these front ends when you lock them in. So that always goes towards the inside. A little grease on here just to make a mess towards the inside. So when it's out, little freewheel, when it's in, it's locked, and a little snap ring hold it in place. There you go. Nice long wheel studs. Let's put this on here real quick. So the reason I haven't been driving the Jeep is for this exact reason. These wheel studs are so short. I just didn't feel comfortable driving it down the road. Didn't think they would hold, especially with these wheels not balanced all that well. And another thing is I have a set of Dana 44s for this Outback. They already have electric lockers and 411s in them. And the only problem is they have brakes on them, and the brakes are too big to go around these wheels. So that means I have to buy new wheels and tires. You know, you're looking at $1,000, $2,000 maybe. So I'm not going to do that right now. I just want to drive this thing. So anyway, wheel nuts, these guys here. It's another dormant part number, and it's 611-170.1, and that is for the matching wheel nut for these wheel studs. Woo! More welding. Notice I was working on the other side and I have this side back apart. Yeah, let me show you. Every now and then this will
every now and then you get bit.
There's an inside and an outside pad. Happens. You think after all this time I would learn to watch for it more?
Well.
That, and I was going to do the rear brakes, but it's 90 degrees in the sun and it's humid and I'm dying. So I'm going in and I will finish this tomorrow. All right. Under the rear brakes, we've got this thing apart. And see how hard it is to get this thing off here. Oh, pop right off. Well, I'd seen better days though. A little bit of dirt, there's material there. These are actually supposed to float in here with hydraulic pressure. Not going anywhere. I know, it's a cheap ratchet. So they're frozen in there, and that's what makes the brake pedal hard. But they don't work. All right, so I spent some time hammering this piston out of this wheel cylinder, and what I found was I found some moisture in there, and I have actually bled these brakes already. And it's because brake fluid absorbs moisture. I know it seems like it's an oil, but I don't know. I'm not a chemist, but it absorbs moisture. There's rust inside here. I thought it'd be more corrosion. I've seen them corrode really, really bad, but this one's actually just because of rust, and it's because of moisture in the brake fluid. You know, these pistons, they need to slide in and out. They basically float in there, and as you step on the brake, the fluid from the master will push through these lines and push these wheel cylinders out. Same thing with the calipers and stuff like that. You have got to get the moisture out of the brake fluid once in a while. So you hear of brake fluid flushes and things like that. There's a reason for it. It's because of the moisture in here, and it'll ruin parts like these. So I'm gonna take a few minutes, throw these brakes back together, do the other side. It's just, you know, brake shoes, brake pads. I got some new ones. I was lucky to find some stuff in town. Different sizes. So I have to do some wiring on this thing. I have to talk to you about wiring, specifically butt connectors. So I work for Chrysler, so I obviously do a ton of wiring. A lot of wiring. Anyway, I am going to show you how Chrysler wants it done. And then I'm going to show you how you're going to do it. So there's, in my opinion, three ways to do this. This, I'm going to show you first, is exactly how Chrysler wants it done. Yeah. So they give you these little copper inserts or pieces to connect wire together with. And then of course you have to buy the expensive crimpers on the tool truck. These can run you anywhere from $70. You can buy a cheaper pair on Amazon. I think you might be able to get it for $40. But you see me struggling with these, probably because I got big fingers, in order to get this in the tool correctly. But once you get it in there, you gotta wiggle two pieces of wire in here. Without the other coming out. As you might imagine, it is a pain. So there you go. And you crimp them. And you're left with a pretty solid connection, correct? It's pretty much what you'll find inside of a butt connector if you cut the jacket off it. Then, I want you to solder it. We're using flux core solder, so you don't need flux. Okay, soldered. Then, put an isolator on it. Shrink tube, whichever you want to call it. They do give you the really nice ones with the glue inside of them. So they're very weather-packed, waterproof. That's how Chrysler wants you to do a butt connector. Perfect, right? Except for it takes time. These tools are expensive. Those little copper inserts aren't always easy to come by, especially ones like that for the tool. So, all right, are you really gonna do it that way? Fumbling around with all those little things, those little copper pieces? No, in the real world, no, I'm not gonna do that. So, three or four of you that are watching this, you probably work on cars anyways. So, you guys have seen these things, right? The little butt connectors with heat shrink on them. Yeah, they're great. You can buy them at Harbor Freight because they're the cheapest there. Put two wires together. A little crimp here. If I get it together. Crimp here. And then you heat it up, right? Heat shrink, all that stuff built in. It's cool. Nice, fast, easy way of doing it. And this is probably how you're gonna do it in the driveway, right? Or in the garage, whatever. Like that. There's a problem. There's actually two problems with this. So, if you're not careful how you crush these, if you smash these like a big gorilla, well, it breaks the wires in this thing. This is, if you crush this thing too much, breaks the wires in here, and you get a decrease in resistance. Well, the decrease in resistance increases current. The increase in current creates heat, and these will melt. So be careful how you crimp these. Now, another problem that you'll have is, and I don't know if you can see it on the camera, but when I crimped these, I also kind of broke this insulation. So these are fine for an environment where you don't get road salt or anything like that. But that is not going to live. Especially, I'm from Central New York, and that'll last maybe a year if you're lucky. So take that. You throw some insulation over the top of it. And then, because I work for Chrysler, and I do a lot of wiring, they have these really nice heat shrink tube pieces that have like this glue stuff inside of them, whatever it is. Awesome. That will probably last you as good as the regular wire itself. That's as good of a connector as you're gonna get if you gotta make a connector. Is it as good as brand new wire? Well, of course not, but that'll probably get you through plenty of years on whatever you're working on. Now, a friend of mine called me the other day, Bob, you know who you are, and reminded me of something that I showed him 20 years ago. And this is something somebody else showed me. If you're in a situation where You don't have a butt connector. You don't have any solder. What do you do? Well, here's what you do. Cut back your insulation a little longer. It's like I have here. And what you're going to do, about halfway up, you're going to twist them around each other, like so. Straighten them out. And then twist the wire back over itself. You don't have a butt connector or any solder. That is super strong. And to top it all off, shrink wrap fits nice and easy over it. A nice quick way without butt connectors or solder. You know, I really hate carburetors. All right, well, so I can't get this thing to stop choking on fuel. I only put a fuel pump in this thing. I was driving it around the neighborhood. I drove it down the road once. I went wheeling with this a couple times and didn't have any problems at all. And the pump quit working, and now the carburetor can't hold back the fuel. I did some digging around online. Supposedly, this Weber carburetor can only handle 3 pounds of fuel pressure. And it said that, or some thread said that these fuel pumps put out 6 pounds of fuel pressure. So I'm guessing that's my problem. So I stopped at AutoZone, got myself a fuel pressure regulator. And we're gonna see what we can do. Hopefully we can get this thing running. If this doesn't fix it, we may have to LS swap this. Wow, this is the first time it's idled without choking on fuel since I put the fuel pump on. So yeah, fuel pressure regulator. I mean, I guess the pump I had on it was bad the whole time and just wasn't providing enough fuel, because like I said, I was driving it around and I had no problems with this thing overfueling. But there you go, it's working good now. It's not misfiring or running like crap. It does sound like it needs spark plug in, you know. But it was really choking on fuel for a while there, so. I tightened up the steering box. And maybe we'll get onto that cowl here eventually, but got a couple lights out too. I noticed both front marker lights up don't work. I took those out, and the bulbs and sockets were all corroded, so. But it's been sitting around forever, so. But I'm happy. We can actually drive it around now. Woohoo! Next up, we're gonna go to the beach.
Mint.
Sweet!
Sweet mint.
I'm gonna tighten up the steering box. Man, it's sloppy.
Zip ties and bias plies. DD Speed Shop, DD Speed Shop, DD Speed Shop.
You're running pretty good. I think this 4.2 liter is gonna be in here for a little while longer. I'm excited to finally get to drive this thing around a little bit. I love it. That'll do it pretty much for this episode of Ridge Runner Garage. We'll get on to something else next time. I think I got another project in the driveway I may start on this weekend. And as always, thanks for watching. Look, new chrome filter. New chrome fuel pressure regulator. It's got to add a couple horsepower, right? Nice.